Every month, we bring you news of the latest jobs report, generally interpreted as a sign of economic health or more. We'll tell you about all of the latest of that tomorrow, but how useful are these numbers really? NewsHour economics correspondent Paul Solman wondered that, too. The answer is part of Paul's ongoing reporting, Making Sense of Financial News.
Breaking news, we have a new jobs report that missed expectations by quite a lot.
The monthly jobs report. It's released by the Bureau of Labor Statistics the first Friday of every month is big news.
The market took off this morning after a far better April jobs report than anyone expected.
The report moves financial markets, prompts instant analysis.
It was not a great report, but it was not a terrible report.
And it spawns spin from the right and left.
These job numbers are pathetic. And, you know, the American people really deserve better.
We welcome today's news that our businesses created another 121,000 jobs last month and the unemployment rate ticked down.
The actual numbers are so sought after, BLS economists like Karen Kazanovich are quarantined in the days and hours leading up to the Friday 8:30 a.m. release.
We're in a secure location. Different parts of the office are physically isolated while production's involved. The suites are actually locked. There's no trash collection or recycling that occurs during that time. Economists have to take out their own trash, and access to those at work areas is limited to people with a definite need to get in.
But economic analyst and money manager Zachary Karabell has a question. Should these numbers matter so much, or matter at all?
We have the desire, an understandable desire, to understand us, understand the world. Numbers are a convenient peg to hang our understanding. The question we should be asking is our complicated reality well served by these kind of simple statistical numbers?
In a new book, The Leading Indicators, Karabell argues that we over-rely on official data, like the GDP, inflation, and the overall jobs figure.
The unemployment number is a synthetic average that treats the nation as unitary. So it acts like we have one unemployment rate in California, and it's the same in Nebraska, and it's the same in Massachusetts. And it's not. Nebraska hasn't had an unemployment rate above 5% throughout this entire crisis, recession, and recovery. Central California, Central Florida, parts of Detroit have had unemployment rates well into the teens for much of this time. So just saying, well, there's an unemployment rate of 6.5% is not going to get you to this very complicated and very variegated reality.
So one objection is that unemployment varies based on where you are and also on your education, as we've found in our own reporting. The job market looked great for college-educated Joe Gellis, whom we met last month in suburban D.C. He was schooled in information security.
There seems to be a lot of availability out there. I've had at least 10 interviews to date.
But employers were blowing off Zakira Thomas with just a high school diploma when we talked to her last summer in inner city Boston.
You don't have the experience we need. You don't have the degree we want you to have. You don't have the things that's required to have this job.
At the time, economist Andrew Sum gave us the stunning statistics for Thomas's male counterparts.
Take a young black high school dropout, low-income male, you're talking 5% employment.
That's a 95% jobless rate. Economist Kazanovich points out that the BLS produces lots of data. Not only is that where Andrew Sum got his numbers.
We prepare a 40-page report with 25 tables and lots of detailed, well-thought-out analysis that doesn't make it into a headline. We produce about 30,000 data series that go online, dozens of online tables. And a few weeks after the national report comes out, we release a report that has state and local area data.
Yet the monthly national employment number, along with the tally of jobs added or lost, gets all the attention. For better or worse. BLS economist Julie Hatch Maxfield.
This is a level of frustration for us because we take time to craft our message, and sometimes we're called to validate things that either are not the truth or not out there.
The government under President Herbert Hoover began collecting national employment data during the Great Depression.
The reason why we have an unemployment rate was because of 1929. And it was because there was a crisis that was clearly unfolding, but there was no sense of just how bad things were, that Hoover himself, who was kind of an apostle of scientific management of government, said, okay, fine, let's fund the Bureau of Labor Statistics sufficiently to create this to create a number that gives us some sense of how bad things are. Lo and behold, that number was quite bad. And Franklin Roosevelt used those preliminary numbers as a way of defeating Hoover in 1932.
Quite bad turned out to be an unemployment rate of 25%, which only dropped to single digits with the huge industrial outlays of World War II. Yet today, though survey methods have evolved, essentially the same data still guide us, says Karabell, at our peril.
They're meant to measure industrial labor forces that worked in factories. They are not really well suited to a kind of 21st century high service economy, fluid labor force that's moving a lot, that isn't working in large factories for large companies. And you know, those numbers bear the stamp of the time they were invented.
But addressing unemployment today, Karabell says, may require spending in particular ways and places on people with particular backgrounds. That may have been the problem with President Obama's 2009 stimulus, for example.
One of the promises of that bill was that $800 billion of spending would translate into 3.5 million jobs created or saved. Now, to be fair, we may have saved 3.5 million jobs because we'll never quite know how many jobs wouldn't have been, you know, would have been lost if we hadn't spent the money. But I think one of the reasons that there was a mismatch between that promise and the outcome is simply that the formulas of macroeconomics that said if you spend X, companies will hire Y. That's clearly breaking down.
So your objection is to people who say, hey, look, all we have to do is pump up aggregate demand, more spending, as opposed to specific demand to hire the people who are currently unemployed.
Exactly. It may have been true when you had a closed economic system, where you couldn't outsource labor, where you didn't have robotics, all these things, that if you simply spent more or you boosted demand, companies would then hire more workers, and it would be this virtuous circle of employment and output and consumption and demand. But if all this is going on in kind of a three-dimensional chess level globally, and if part of it's robotics, part of it's labor, part of it's just changing industries, then those correlations don't need to exist.
It's a new world, says Karabell. And the longer we obsess over the monthly unemployment rate,
it's definitely weaker, but not a disaster,
the longer it may take to help put millions of Americans back to work.